Okay, so quantum coherent networks. The topic is kind of challenging because we really go deep into the mysteries of quantum physics. Okay, so maybe not all of you are so familiar with it. So I will try to keep it a little bit simple. Maybe at some points a little bit oversimplified. But nevertheless, it's really a challenge. The challenge to, so to say, implement quantum technology. The experiments also are not so easy. It took us one or maybe two decades to set up the experiments that I will talk about to you today. So why do we want to do these challenging experiments? Well, basically there are two answers to this. One answer is, well, we take up the challenge. I mean, it's fun, okay? And the other answer is, conceptually, the experiments are really very, very simple, okay? They are so simple that I think any one of you, not only the people in the first row here, but any one of you should be able to get at least an idea of what we are doing in this quantum world, okay? So we are really using quantum concepts, but the experiments and the implementations are very much like in the classical world. Okay, so that was basically my introduction. So why do we want to do this? Well, I mean, this is a quantum computer, as you can see. A quantum computer does not exist yet. But at some point it will exist, and maybe it looks like this. This is a picture, by the way, that I've stolen from the Scientific American page, but I like it. But I will not talk about quantum computers. I will talk about this cable here. Well, actually, I will not talk about the cable. I will talk about the interface of how to interface the cable with the quantum computer. And this is basically the topic of my talk, quantum network, because this computer will be connected to something else. So why do we want to do this? Well, a quantum network could, in principle, enable users to interact in ways that are not possible with current technology. Let me give you three examples out of many, many others. Okay, but due to limited time, I don't want to go into the details too much. One reason why a quantum network would be interesting is that it's the quantum no-cloning theorem, which exists in the quantum world, but does not exist in the classical world. You can clone sheep in the classical world, but you cannot clone quantum states. Okay, but quantum no-cloning theorem allows for private queries. That means you can search the internet, the quantum internet. You can search without leaving a trace, so nobody will be able to follow up what you're doing. Another thing is that quantum computers at some point, very much like classical computers, download classical software. A quantum computer could download quantum software from the internet. And maybe at some point in the future, definitely not tomorrow or maybe next week or next month, but at some point the quantum internet might even teleport physical objects from one place to the other. Okay, so that's a kind of motivation. It's a bit, so to say, application-driven, but on the other hand, there are many, many scientific questions. So why do we care about this? Well, there are a couple of answers to this, and I can only give a short selection here. For example, there's a question of how large can quantum systems actually be? Okay, and then another question is, how is entanglement distributed in space and time? What kind of protocol is best to distribute entanglements? Do we talk, or do we want to use continuous variables, or do we want to discrete variables? Do we want to use pulsed experiments, or is it steady-state experiments? That's an open question. What is multipartite entanglement? Okay, so we know, we learn all that entangling two particles is kind of easy to understand. The problem already arises when you go to three particles. There are two different classes of entangled states, the GHZ states and the W states, for example, which cannot be transferred from one class, so to say, into the other class. So that's also already a kind of mystery or kind of observation. But the problem becomes really difficult when we go to 4, 5, 6, 7 and more particles. Nobody really knows of how to quantify, characterize and so on, this multi-particle entanglement if it comes to more than three particles. And in the end, what means large? Okay, what means large? Am I large? Am I small? Compared to what? Okay, so there are basically two things that I can say about large. Large could either mean distance, large distance, or large could mean in terms of number, many particles. When we talk about large distance, then what I have in mind is communication, in particular quantum communication. You want to communicate quantum states from one place to the other. There are many open questions, like the question of quantum non-locality. No loophole-free Bell test so far has been done. There are always loopholes, so the question is quantum physics really non-local or not? The next question is about repeater, quantum repeater. If you want to communicate quantum information over large distances, we would like to have a repeater. We need a repeater. The question is how to build a repeater, how to apply a repeater. There are many, many open questions. If I talk about number, large number, I'm talking about quantum simulators, quantum computers. There are many open questions like quantum phase transitions. How is entanglement distributed in space? Where does entanglement live? Does it live in the inside? Does it live on the edges? Does it live on the outside of the object I'm talking about? This is all, so to say, not clear. And of course, the question about the computer. Can I really build a quantum computer? And there are many open questions, and I will argue during my talk that if you really want to have this scalable, we need both. We need communication and we need computer. So if, for example, communication will need computational gates in order to build a quantum repeater or so. And also the quantum computer will need communication because, as I outlined in the previous transparency, we want to download quantum software, download states and so on. We want to make large number of particles in the computer, so we need to communicate information from one place in the computer to the other. So communication, quantum communication and quantum computing is not so much of a difference as we will see. So let me begin basically asking the question, how can we transfer a quantum state from one place to the other? How can we do this? Well, the first thing is, of course, we can make a measurement. We can make a measurement on the system, on this psi, and then we communicate the information we have obtained to the other sides, and by some means we generate another quantum state, and then we have this state communicated. However, there's a problem, and the problem is that in quantum physics there are complementary non-commuting observables, so in one single shot we can't do such kind of experiment. We have to make repetitions on an ensemble average that would work, but in a single realization it doesn't work. So the next thing would be what something I call pack and go. Well, this quantum state lives somehow. It lives in a molecule, it lives in an atom, it lives in an ion, and so on. So it lives in a physical object. We can just take this physical object, put it on a truck, drive the truck 100 miles to the other place, and unload the state, including vacuum system and whatever, maybe helium refrigerators, whatever it needs, and unload it there. But the road can be kind of bumpy. Okay, and it takes a long time because the truck will be stuck in a traffic jam or whatever. So this is not practical, it's slow, it suffers from decoherence, so this is typically not what we want. So the preferred method, or one of the methods, would be take a more suitable communication link for the quantum state. So take a suitable object, map the quantum state of wherever it lives, put it into this other object, roll the other object to the other side, and then map the quantum state again on the other object. And that should at least work in principle over infinite distances. Okay? In particular, if this rolling object is a photon, for example, that can propagate through optical fibers over very, very long distances. So what we want, in order to do this experiment, we want a scalable quantum node which is capable to send and receive qubits, which is able to store and retrieve qubits, and which is able to entangle qubits, distribute entanglement over many of these quantum nodes. And this kind of thing simply does not exist. I mean, you might not believe me, but it doesn't exist. And I will tell you about, so to say, the implementation that we have done over the last couple of years. So what is the implementation? Well, we need channels and nodes. In our case, the channels are photons propagating through optical fibers. It's a flying photon. The information is encoded as a polarization state of the photon, but it doesn't need to be the polarization state. It can also be a timing qubit or so. But in our case, it is just a polarization. What is the stationary memory? This is a single atom, it's a stationary atom. The atom has long-lived internal state, so it can keep the information, keep the coherence over a very long time. And this movie just shows you a single atom which is quasi permanently trapped at rest at some point in space. The movie takes 8 minutes, but I will not use these 8 minutes now because nothing will happen except, so to say, that you can see the single atom moving and moving, well, not moving, sitting there and doing something. So what is the interface? How do we interface the atom with the photon? Well, we take an optical cavity, because an optical cavity, and this is something I don't have to explain to this audience, I guess, the optical cavity combines the best of two worlds. In one way, we just have a single atom, and the single atom is a natural emitter of single photons. On the other hand, there are all these mirror images, which the atom would see in the mirrors. So it looks like, from the outside world, it looks like there are many, many atoms. They're all in phase with each other. And in case of a very high reflectivity of the mirrors, there are many, many mirror images. In our case, it's of the order of 10 to 5 or 10 to 6 mirror images because we are using a finesse of 10 to 5 or 10 to 6, something like this. So there are many kinds of optical cavities. I don't want to go into the details here. There are many kinds of optical cavities, like Fabry-Perot cavities or whispering gallery mode cavities or toroid cavities or fiber cavities or bottles, so-called bottle resonators, which are maybe these ones here. And they're investigated by many groups in the world. It's really an exploding field, if you like. And I've just listed a few experimental groups here. I don't go into the details. And this will be the only place where I mention other groups. And I apologize that I cannot mention the theorists because there are too many theorists out there who really actively participate in this field. But I'm really afraid that if I make a list of theorists, I miss the other one, miss one or the other, and so I don't do that. Anyway, so this is a kind of, so to say, technology that one can use, but I will not give a technological talk. I will just, so to say, try to emphasize the basic physics, and the basic physics, so to say, is this atom here sitting between two highly reflecting mirrors, in this case in a kind of Fabry-Perot situation. Why is a Fabry-Perot cavity a nice mirror? Well, I probably don't have to explain to you because probably many of you work with Fabry-Perot cavities. But the Fabry-Perot cavity has the advantage that it provides good optical access to a single atom. It's easily tunable to an atomic frequency, just change the cavity length. It has high quality or high finesse cavity because the photons basically live outside the mirror in vacuum and there are no losses. And its polarization, it allows to make it polarization degenerate, which is important for our qubits, and it's a fiber-ready technology. The only disadvantage, if you like, is that in our case, for example, the cavities are not too small. They are sub-millimeter, but they're not sub-micron. And so to some extent, they are slow. They can be operated at megahertz speed, but not gigahertz, okay? At least not with the technology that we developed. So let me give you a kind of flavor of what these cavities are supposed to do. Well, this is my atom between highly reflecting mirrors. There's some mode waste. This has high finesse. And the point is, how can we actually make a single photon absorbed by a single atom? If you take a single photon, it comes in a light beam, basically, and you can focus down the light beam to something like a mode area, like this one here, in paraxial approximation. But you don't hit the atom. The atom has a much smaller absorption cross-section, which is basically lambda squared, the wavelength of the light which we are using. So this number here is very, very small. Most of the photons just pass by the atom and are not absorbed. So that's not good. So the idea is, with this cavity, is to bounce the photon many, many times. As I said, 100,000 or million times. And then actually this total expression here becomes larger, or in fact much larger than one. So that's one ingredient and one secret of these experiments. Where, so to say, if we are in this regime, one atom can make a really big difference and we can do real-time experiments with single atoms, like real-time feedback on the motion of a single atom. The other ingredient is, well, we would like to, so to say, have coherence dominating decoherence or incoherence. What do I mean by incoherence? Well, I mean spontaneous emission, because spontaneous emission radiates into any kind of direction. And we want to have the atom emitting a photon into a certain direction, okay, to make it the deterministic emission of single photons. That means the spontaneous emission rate needs to be smaller than the stimulated emission rate for just one photon. And again, the stimulated emission rate for per photon is just this absorption cross section lambda squared times the speed of light over the density, times the density, which is just 1 over volume. So in order to make the stimulated rate per photon large, we need to go to small volume, okay, small size cavities. The smaller the better, and the higher finesse the better. And in this situation, one photon really makes a big difference to the system. The presence or absence of a photon is a big, big difference. And this is the underlying reason why with this kind of system, you can do a lot of quantum nonlinear optics experiments, which you cannot do with classical laser beams. For example, like photon blockade, where one photon blocks the transmission of another photon in this kind of system. But I will not talk about this. This is a picture of our system. Basically, what you see is two mirrors, a two-cone glass mirror with a spacing here where the atom is supposed to live. And this atom there is trapped, it's laser-cooled and so on. It sits there at rest. It sits there at rest as good as quantum physics allows. It's an emotional ground state of a vibration of a trap in between these mirrors. The electron spin and the nuclear spin are controlled perfectly well, and the radiation properties are changed in such a way that it's strongly coupled to one optical light mode. Okay, so it's in some way the most ideal situation where all degrees of freedom of a single atom are perfectly controlled.